we're going to move on to our final speaker for this webinar, and that is Dr. Anand Swaroop. He's chief of the Neurobiology, Neurodegeneration and Repair Laboratory at the National Eye Institute. His laboratory primarily focuses on photoreceptor development and retinal macular degeneration diseases, including elucidation of transcriptional regulatory pathways involved in cell fate and homeostasis, the genetic basis of retinal defects, and the development of treatments using cell, gene, or small molecule-based approaches. Welcome, Dr. Swaroop.
Thank you, Sean, and I'm delighted to be here. Blindness generally ranks second or third among all the fear or scary diseases in this world. In many, many surveys after cancer or cardiovascular diseases, people are very scared of going blind. What I'm going to tell you today is some of the research that we are doing on transcriptional regulatory networks to produce a photoreceptor cell that captures light, and also going to tell you how some of this research is leading to new paradigms for finding treatment for retinal and macular degeneration. Retina, in fact, is our window to this visual world and also to brain. Dr. Zalate earlier said we have no window to the brain. Actually, retina is. It's the most approachable part of the central nervous system. At any point in time and space, you can look at thousands, in fact, over 100,000 individuals of different size, shapes, color. You can look at their location in a visual field. You can see them moving around. And despite all these objects, you are able to focus on a single individual if you choose to. All of this visual information is processed through cells in the back of our eye called retina. In fact, light is focused through various optical elements called cornea and lens that many of you are aware of. And that focused light goes to retina, which is relatively simple, but architecturally a beautiful stratified part of central nervous system. There are six major types of neurons, as shown on the right side of this slide. These neurons are organized in three layers of cells. The layer which is at the bottom actually is an epithelial layer called retinal pigment epithelium, or RPE, which is extremely important for supporting the cells next to those. These are photoreceptors. And I'm going to talk to you more about the photoreceptors a little later. The information that is captured by photoreceptors goes through a bunch of different kinds of neurons in different types of interneurons. And then these neurons convey information to ganglion cells and axons of these ganglion cells from optic nerve, and that takes information to different parts of brain. All of this information actually is captured, integrated, processed, to certain extent, at least in the retina. In fact, 30% of our brain is devoted to processing of visual information. As one can imagine, degeneration of these cells, which are post-mitotic, will lead to blindness. Even though we have treatment for certain kind of blinding disorders, like cataract and to certain extent glaucoma, retinal and macular degeneration are still a major cause of untreatable blindness. They're highly heterogeneous, both clinically and genetically. If you look at the left, rather right, the top part shows you the picture of a fundus. If you look in the eye of an individual, this is what you will see, beautifully, nicely colored, uniformly colored part. You can see optic disc, which has got, which is where optic nerve goes through, and then optic vessels come in the retina. The center of this retina is fovea. That's where highest visual acuity is, and that's where the light actually gets focused. The area around fovea is called macula, and degeneration of photoreceptors and underlying pigment epithelium cells will lead to macular degeneration. And as you can see in the picture below, a degeneration of photoreceptors in the macular region will lead to loss of central vision, and you will not be able to see or drive or watch TV. Whereas on the right side of that, you have another picture of the fundus where there is degeneration of photoreceptors in the peripheral retina, and that leads to loss of peripheral vision. Even though your central vision is okay, you will not be able to see on the periphery. There are many, many different genes that can lead to retinal and macular diseases. As written here, over 200 genes have been mapped, and more than 150 have already been identified. Many genes can lead to same phenotype, and sometimes the same gene and even the same mutation in a family can lead to distinct phenotypes for a variety of reasons. Retinal degeneration is also observed as part of numerous syndromic diseases, and in fact, we have been working on many, there are many diseases like nephronesthesis and others where you have kidney disorders or other neurological disorders along with retinal degeneration. And then you have multifactorial disease like age-related macular degeneration. So in majority of these diseases, dysfunction of death of photoreceptors leads to loss of vision. There are two kinds of photoreceptors, rods, which allow you to see in the night, and cones, which are actually much less in number. In humans, it's only 5% of all photoreceptors, but they allow you to see in bright light. They are responsible for high resolution and also color vision. And color vision is mediated by different kinds of cone receptors because they include different visual pigments. Short wavelength, for like S cones, M cones have medium wavelength visual pigment, and long wavelength are L cones in human. In mice, you have only two kinds of cones, S cones and M cones. Photoreceptors are highly active, metabolically active cells. And the reason is that these highly polarized cells have got these membrane discs, as you can see on top of these photoreceptors. 10% of these discs are shed every day. That means the whole outer segment is regenerated every year, or rather every 10 days. And even though these cells are post-mitotic and they do not regenerate, the outer segment part, which is where the light is captured, has to be replaced every 10 days. And these outer segment discs are like membrane discs which contain phototransduction material. Now, my lab over the last 20 plus years has focused on all aspects of photoreceptor biology. We look at photoreceptor differentiation, look at aging of photoreceptors, many, many different diseases that are caused by defects in photoreceptor function, and then eventually trying to look at the treatment for these photoreceptor diseases. Today, however, I will briefly focus in this short duration on networks that are involved in differentiation of photoreceptors and how we are trying to identify treatments. Photoreceptors, and in fact, all retinal neurons and glia are generated from common pools of suppressor cells. And as on the left you can see, rod photoreceptors, which dominate the retina, there are over 70% of all cells in the retina, their birth overlaps with the birth of all other cells. There's a conserved order of birth. And as you can see on the right, this photoreceptor differentiation, like other differentiation of different cell types, proceeds in a very simple manner. You have dividing multipotent progenitor cells. At some point in their differentiation, they become lineage restricted. Then when they exit cell cycle, they have their fate specified. And then through a variety of regulatory pathways, these photoreceptors acquire function. Multiple transcription factors are involved in generating in this pathway. However, let us focus towards the right only on transcription factors that are involved in photoreceptor self-fate determination. The primary factor there is NRL. Along with that, you have a bunch of other factors, CRX, which is a homeodomain transcription factor, very critical for both rod and cone photoreceptors. TR-beta-2 is primarily for cone differentiation, and NR2E3. Several years ago, an excellent postdoc in my lab, Alan Mears, made a knockout for this NRL gene and showed that if you knock out this gene, a loss of function of this specific gene leads to a cone-only retina. You have no longer any type of rods. There's this complete fate switch. At the bottom of the slide, you could see the ERG, or electroretinogram, that shows the functional characteristics of these photoreceptors. In wild type, you can see the dark-adapted ERG is very high, but in knockout, it's flat. Dark-adapted ERG shows the response of rods. Light-adapted is for cone cells, and you could see there is a huge increase in cone response in this NRL knockout retina. And what is even more exciting for us was when this graduate student at what he did was he took NRL and expressed it under the control of CRX promoter, which is both in rods and cones, and showed that now all cones become rods. So NRL alone is sufficient to convert cone photoreceptors to rod photoreceptors. And in fact, if you drive NRL expression under the control of S-opsin promoter, which is when the cone cells are actually even at a different stage in differentiation, even then, some of these differentiating cone photoreceptors can get converted to rods, as much as 40% of these cells. Something which is even more exciting for us, working with Douglas Forrest here at NIDDK, we showed that TR-beta-2 and NRL, these two transcription factors, are present in certain photoreceptor precursors at the same time. As I mentioned earlier, TR-beta-2 is responsible for M-cone differentiation, whereas NRL is for rod differentiation. What are they doing in the same cell? What we believe is happening is that there is some sort of tug of war going on between different transcription factors, and they can then sort of determine what they're going to be. And this particular slide shows us the transcriptional regulatory network. I'm not going to go into the detail of that, but what it shows is that the default pathway is the S-cone pathway, and if you have NRL, you're going to make a rod photoreceptor. If you have no NRL, you're going to go towards the S-cone, or if TR-beta-2 is there, you're going to make an M-cone. Now, another postdoc in the lab showed that if you can take the NRL promoter and drive GFP, you could label the rod photoreceptors as soon as they are born. This is extremely important because now we can flow sort these cells, and these flow sorted photoreceptor cells can be utilized to develop gene regulatory networks during differentiation. And under in disease processes, you could use these purified photoreceptor for cell replacement and for drug discovery. Now, what we have been doing in this brief slide, I'm going to give you a whole lot of background, rather a whole lot of information. What we have been doing is we have been trying to look at the networks that guide the differentiation of newborn photoreceptors to a functional photoreceptors by doing RNA-seq and other profiling, global profiling. We are doing ChIP-seq with using different transcription factors, histone modification studies, and DNA methylation. And I've listed the names of postdocs and fellows who have been involved in this particular work. Now, several years ago, we collaborated with a group in London and showed that we could take these photoreceptor precursors, the newborn NRL positive photoreceptors, and we can transplant in degenerating retina. And these cells will then not only differentiate, but also integrate within the retina and could give you some function. But you need to have these immature developing rods. Once the cells differentiate, that means fully differentiate, they have outer segments, they can no longer function or integrate within this degenerating retina. This has been very exciting development. A large number of labs have now been trying to use this technology to approach stem cell-based therapy for retinal repair. Here is another slide working with David Zaks. We showed that you could put that in a degenerating retina and these cells can integrate, and as shown here. And they are viable for several months. Kohei Homa in the lab has recently have got a paper now in press. We showed that these NRL GFP positive developing rod photoreceptors, when you integrate them in a degenerating retina, they are functional. And their function is very similar. Their membrane properties by using patch clamp and other studies are very similar to native rods. Now, how do you make these rod photoreceptors if you want to do transplantation therapy? You could do that from human embryonic stem cells, IPS, or induced pluripotent stem cells, and you could develop these immature photoreceptors for a variety of different uses at a later stage. Now, this is just one of the slides that I wanted to put in here. Pioneering work in the lab of Dr. Sasai in Japan showed last year, or in 2011 actually, that you could make eye in a dish from both mouse, and later on he showed it from human ES cells. And this, we have been using their protocols to develop human retina in a dish, and Rosukan and Kohei and Jessica in the lab have been working on these strategies to look at, to generate neural retina. Now, what we have also discovered very recently is that the retinal photoreceptors, if you make them in a dish, do not have outer segments and they will not respond to light. For that, you require retinal pigment epithelium integrity, and this was another work that we have published very recently in development, where we show RP is critical for only outer segment morphogenesis. Cell fate is still conserved, but outer segments are not there if RPE is not properly polarized. So what do we need to have cell-based replacement therapies for retinal and macular degeneration? We need to generate photoreceptors, but we can make these cells, but we still need to do a little bit more work on epigenetics and other characteristics of these cells. We should also be able to purify these cells without using GFP. Otherwise, it will be hard for us to transplant these in humans. Transplanting methods have become pretty good these days, but we need to find ways so that the cells do not clump, and we might require some sort of biomaterial or a scaffold. Cell integration is still relatively poor. Only a small number of cells get integrated in the retina. We need to figure out ways to improve that. We also need to find fundamental methods to generate their connections. And we are also working on many different methods for better assessment, for efficacy in animal models. Eventually, we believe that we need to have some sort of 3D reconstruction of outer retina if we want to have treatment for retinal and macular degenerative diseases. I'm going to stop there. This is our group. A large number of people have been involved in this work. Along with that, we have several collaborators. I'm going to stop with this quote from Helen Keller: "The only thing worse than being blind is having sight, but no vision." Thank you.